Hey everybody, today your auto talks through an update to Welcome to Centerville, which is a very, very cool Yahtzee-style dice rolling city building game that I did a run through for a couple of years ago in prototype form when it was on publisher GMT's P500 system. It's now available, and so I figured I'd spend a few minutes today walking you through a final retail version so you can see what's changed since my original run-through. So here's what you get. Now, if you watch my original run-through, you'll notice, hey, it's still basically the same layout. The board is certainly much nicer looking. It has really lovely graphic design. It's introduced some extra spaces on the board to store various things. There's more reminders of how everything works. I mean, overall, it's a really great presentation. The game also comes with an even improved version of the excellent player aid, and the player aid was already amazing in the prototype I had. But, so for the most part, I would say 90% of the game is exactly the same as what I demonstrate. So you can go back and watch that run through and get a pretty good idea of what the game feels like. There's a few changes. Probably the second biggest change in the new version is that the function of most of the political offices have changed. The mayor no longer duplicates what the other offices do. Instead, the mayor lets you scream up the status track. The police and fire commissioner, now if you become the commissioner, you get a safe token, which means disasters won't bother you. That's awesome. The finance and city council, which give you more money or prestige, it's not a fixed two that you move up. Instead, you move up based on your highest value house. So a nice mansion in the hills could really pay off well if you're the finance or city council folks. And so on. So, I would say on the whole, are more interesting. Well worth fighting over a little bit more. Urban Planner lets you take a whole nother turn. Very, very cool stuff. But functionally, they're still the same. You got to get at least two, you have to roll at least two, vote dice, or the vote in the wild, to be able to move in. And then once you've got it, you get the benefit, and over time you lose your benefit and you can get voted out. All that stuff works the same. It's just the function of the offices change. So that's a pretty big deal. But the bigger deal is the way the game handles two-player. You remember in the original, the only thing that was done for two-player was a bunch of spaces on the board were blocked off with dummy tokens, so there were just fewer spaces you could grab when you were constructing. That was fine, it worked, but it wasn't great. And it was my one big complaint about the game back then, because so much of this game is area control. Whoever has the most in a given area scores 6 points. Whoever has the least loses 3. And in a two-player game, that 9-point spread was very unsatisfying. It just didn't feel good. Plus there's these legacy tiles that create that same 9-point spread for first to last place. So what Chad Jensen, the designer, did is he went back to the drawing board for two-player. He got rid of all of the notion of blocking off spaces on the board. No matter what player count, all of the board spaces are available to build right from the get-go. And he introduced a bot, a third autonomous player who, after I go and then you go, the bot goes. And then I go, you go, the bot goes. He always takes the third turn. And while some people might be put off by that because I don't have to do a lot of maintenance and deciding for an automatic player, I gotta tell you folks, this system works so well. It's just so silky smooth. The bot's turns are over in a flash. I mean, they take a fraction of the time that a human player's turn takes. And I'm just gonna show you how the bot works. So I've actually set up a game. We're kind of still early on. There's been some terrain grabbed. Jen and I'm the yellow player. Jen's the white player. We've got a couple of offices. The bot is the brown player. You can see the bot's already grabbed one space on the river and has already worked up the green belt a little bit. Might have even grabbed a few vocational tiles already, because the bot is capable of doing everything we do. Now, the bot is not a real competitor. The bot is never going to score enough points to win this game. Humans will always beat the bot. The only thing the bot is doing is grabbing resources that you might have really wanted a vocation tile, and he'll grab it before you do. You might have really wanted to hold on to a political office, but he'll kick you out. You might have really wanted to grab a spot on the river or even on the bridge. He might grab it before you do. On his turn, he just rolls the dice the exact same way the players do, but he uses them in a very different way. So let's say I took a turn, Jen took a turn, it is now the bot's turn. Here's the dice. They're very, very nice, colorful dice. Not etched. Silk screen? I'm not quite sure what the term is, but they're nice, high quality, fun, thick, chunky dice. Anyway, so the bot is going to roll. He rolls up to 3 times, just like players. So he rolls, and okay, he's done. Let me try a roll again. So let's say this is his first roll. There we go, yeah. So he rolls and accepts every single result he gets, except for the wild cards, or I think they're called the fate results, the question marks. He doesn't like question marks. So he's gonna lock all of these other ones in. He's totally happy with all of those, and he will now re-roll a second time. Okay, and so now he got a vote. He is done rolling. Now, if he had gotten this again, he'd roll a third time and try to get rid of it, and then he'd be fine. But it's possible after his three rolls, he might still have a few question marks, and he'll use them. All he does is he wants to roll three times to get rid of all the question marks. Now, in this case, he did. This is what he, or what was my other roll? All right, so this is what he ended up with. In two rolls, he got rid of his question marks, and now he's going to use the dice he got very, very quickly, very efficiently. Let me show you how it works. It's a very quick checklist. Well, the first thing he does, if he still had any question marks, he uses them to push his wealth or his, prestige up. Because remember, at the end of the game, whichever of these is the lower is how you finally score. So if he had some question marks, if he had two question marks, since his wealth is down, he would move up two times. If his wealth and prestige are equal, he gets to move them both up. That's what he does with question marks. It's very quick. Question marks, just move his lowest thing up and that's it. They're done. Then he moves on to trees. And if he gets one tree, or three or four or five, all he does is he just moves up the green belt that many spaces. If he makes it all the way to the end, ends up putting a disaster tile in the bag like a normal human player. If he keeps on trying to go up, he pushes the other players down, just like a regular human would. Now that's an interesting thing. Whenever the dummy player would have to make a choice, because like if he made it to the top of the green belt and he were to go higher, either Jen or I would have to drop. He doesn't make any choices. Whenever he has to make a choice, the player who is highest on the status track gets to choose for him. So in the two-player game, being highest on the status track is even more important than normal because you get to make decisions for the dummy in the rare circumstance he does. If he were up and obviously I'm the highest status one, on his behalf, I would choose that Jen would lose a space if he were to keep climbing, et cetera, et cetera. But in this case, you know, he just got one, so he's just gonna move up one and he's now tied with me on the green belt, which might be important because, hey, there might be a legacy card or a legacy chip in play to be the master of the green belt. And he just tied me, he might have taken that away. Now I've gotta pay more to catch up with him. Well, that's another thing as well. Like the regular game I demonstrated, the prototype, everybody has their own legacy tile that's kept secret, it's revealed at the end. The dummy player gets a legacy tile as well, but it's public, which I gotta say is really, really cool. It's awesome to have another public objective. This only happens in a two-player game that players are fighting for. In this game, we know right from the get-go that grabbing terrain, getting cubes into the commercial district is hugely important because the dummy player's legacy tile is public knowledge, not a secret. Secret, unlike players' ones. So anyway, so he just uses his trees and moves up the track very quickly, unless he rolled two trees. Let's say he happened to roll two trees now instead. If he has exactly two, no more or no less. Let's say he rolled two trees. Instead of moving up two spaces on the track, he will claim waterfront property. And so basically, what he'll do is he will look at his current status, and whichever is lower, money or prestige, he will take another river space, another riverfront property. Right now his money's low, he's already got one riverfront property, he's gonna take the next one. He takes the one that's closest to the bridge if he can. So if he had two, he says, oh, my money's low, I'll get the money-based riverfront. If he rolled two in the future, his money's low, he would end up taking the third one. If there are none that he wants to take, instead, he'll just move forward two on the track. Now, the other thing as well, if he's tied, if both of these, his money and his prestige are at the same time, instead of him trying to take a riverfront property on the north or the south side of the bridge, he'll take the bridge instead. Which of course is probably the most valuable spot in the whole game. And in fact, when he does that, if a player had already taken it, he will kick the player out to take it. He does not need prestige to kick a player off, or I'm sorry, not prestige, he doesn't need favor tokens to kick a player off the bridge. So, there aren't very many waterfront bridge spaces, and he can play very aggressively for them if he ends up with trees, specifically if he ends up with two. If he ended up with three trees, he would ignore that and he would just move up three on the track. So anyway, so let's say he had two trees and that's what he did. All right, So he's done resolving trees. I mean, this literally takes seconds. You see how many trees? He either grabs land or he moves up. Easy peasy. Next, he moves on to education. Now, in this case, he didn't roll any education, so you just move on. But if he had rolled some education, let's say he had rolled education instead with these two dice. What he does is he takes the highest value vocational tile he can. He got two education, so that means he goes to the level two space and takes the one lowest, in this case, the arts. It's rarer, so that's why he's gonna grab it. If he had gotten three education, he'd take the lowest one down here. If he had gotten four education, he never bothers with media, he doesn't use media. If he'd gotten four, he would have taken the best level three, and then he would have had one hat left over, so he would have taken the level one. So he could take multiple vocation tiles. And at the end of the game, if he rolls a lot of education, he'll end up grabbing a lot of those tiles. And those might have been tiles the player wanted. So it's super simple. Depending on how many hats he rolled, he gets one or more vocation tiles. The more he rolls, the better the tiles he takes. That's it. Education is super duper simple. No real decision making at all. And again, over in seconds. After, if he'd rolled hats and you deal with that, then he moves on to construction. And in this case, he rolled two construction dice. So let's talk about what he would do. Basically, for every construction die, or every construction face he rolled, a purple and a yellow one, a commercial and a residential, he tries to claim a level one space in that zone. Let's say in purple that there was a level one space. You know, he's taken one, I've taken one, there's another level one space left over. He rolled a purple, so he tries to take that. Easy peasy. But he also wants a level one yellow space. There aren't any available. He's already taken two and Jen's taken one. So if there isn't a level one available for him to take when he wants to grab a space, he instead upgrades one of his level ones to a level two. But now there's another level one that he might grab in the future, or another player could grab. So he gets the upgrade, which is the equivalent of using the public works action. He just basically gets to upgrade. But let's say we were playing and Jen and I had taken all the level ones. And so there was no level one for him to take, but he had a level two, then he can upgrade to a level three, which is pretty cool. Or you can upgrade a level three to a level four. Now, if he doesn't have anything and there's no spaces for him to take, if he has previously earned a favor, because he can earn favor tiles just like a player, if it's impossible for him to take a level one space or upgrade an existing one to another level, if he has a favor, he will use a favor to kick one of the players out to take a level one, just like a human player would do. And once again, who does he kick out? It depends. The player who has the highest status gets to choose. So I have the highest status. In this case, I would say, oh, well, he'll kick Jen out. He'll spend his favor to kick Jen out. And now we are tied. We all have a level one space in the yellow because he rolled yellow. So again, super duper simple. It takes seconds. It's usually, you can see, oh look, he doesn't have a level one, he takes it. Oh, he already has a level one, he upgrades it to level two. Occasionally, rarely, he might kick somebody out, but more often he's just gonna upgrade the stuff he's already got and get more and more control over the regions by having more higher valuable stuff. So anyway, that's construction. Again, super duper simple. And then after that, he moves on to politics. Now in this case, we're saying he rolled one politic die. It's the blue one. So we look over here, and now, remember, for human players, you have to have at least two to get in, but if there's already somebody there, you have to have more than them. So for Jen to get into public works, into the blue zone, she'd have to have three to kick me out. The dummy player doesn't work that way. If the dummy player rolls where somebody already is, instead of moving in, he just makes that player lose one. He kind of erodes the base. So now it's going to be harder for me to hold on to public works because he rolled that. And then in a future turn, if he rolled blue again, he would pull me out some more. He only did a single. In a future turn, if nobody's there and he rolled the blue, that's when he moves in himself and starts climbing his way up. So the more politics he rolls, I mean, if he rolls a lot of politics early in the game, he could end up taking all the offices, but only with a single. But if he keeps rolling, he can slowly build his base. But in the meantime, if we're already there, instead of him building, he just erodes our base. It's super duper simple. Again, very quick, very easy to do. And now he never uses the powers of these at all. He doesn't care about powers. He basically, all he does is he just uses the the dice and then moves on. But the more public offices he has, the less ones we have. Because remember, there's a lot of vying for control over public office. A lot of points are to be had for the player who has more offices, and he can try and grab those too. That's what he does with his voting cubes. And then the last thing, if he has any hourglasses or benches, he treats them both the same. For each hourglass or bench he has, in this case he had one hourglass, he never moves the timer forward. He never does that. For every bench or hourglass that he has, he moves forward one on the status track. So in this case, he had one, so he moves forward one and he kicks me down. He is now the top dog on status. He kicked me out, so he gave me a favor. Just like if a human player kicked me out, I get a favor. He kicked me out, he gets a favor. Oh, another thing, at the beginning of the game, he is a double star instead of a single star. He starts out upgraded, unlike us. We have to actually earn that upgrade over time. So anyway, so he would kick me up. Now, I still am in the lead status among human players, so I would still make decisions on his behalf, like in a case where he has to kick one or the other player out of a given space. But it's pretty rare that he makes decisions. 9 times out of 10, when you are just going through, I mean, his turn, you roll, maybe you roll a third time, and then you just go down the checklist. His turn is generally under 20 seconds long. Occasionally, he'll have to make a decision, and then you just see, okay, which player is in the lead on status. That player gets to choose for him, and obviously, they'll choose in their favor, and that's it. That's everything he does. He's super cool. I'm shocked just how smooth and elegant he works. Now, like I said, he's not going to win the game because he's not making choices that are smart to give him a lot of points, but he will definitely be a viable presence for control over the areas. He will often be in first or second space for each of the four areas because he builds a lot. He will often be a contender for having the most political offices because he can move in very, very easily. At the end of the game, he might have more vocational tiles than anybody else if he rolled educational law, because it's easy for him to get those. And that's pretty much it. It works brilliantly. I am very, very impressed. Jen and I enjoy it a lot, and it makes the two-player game so nice. Especially, I would even go so far as it makes the two-player game better because you're getting a richer ecosystem because you're playing a three-player game, but one of the players has absolutely no analysis paralysis at all. So you get a full three-player experience, but in a much faster time because Welcome to Centerville is a surprisingly crunchy game. I mentioned this when I did the original run-through. Even though it's a simple Yahtzee at its core, there's a lot of complex stuff, a lot of thinking and strategizing that goes into this game. It can be pretty AP inducing, depending on how you want to use those dice. But the dummy player, he never has AP. He is the fastest player in the West, and he is a viable contender. So he's fun to actually play against. So I can heartily recommend Welcome to Centerville now as a two-player game, which I really couldn't do originally because I just didn't think the original two-player rules were that great. Now, if you're playing with three or four players, there is no bot. You just it's a three or four-player game. So everything works normally. It's only as a two-player that you bring him in, but he works so great. Now, I have to admit, I am shocked that Chad Jensen, the designer, did not actually make solo rules. I don't see why he couldn't. I would think this bot, if you by yourself, you could probably play against two bots and have a pretty good solo game here. I haven't tried it, but I bet it would work. I'm really curious to hear other people if they've been able to pull that off, because I think Centerville could be a really fun solo game played against two bots. But there must be a reason they didn't do that, and they left it officially as a 2-to-4-player game. It says it somewhere on the box. But anyway, so that's pretty cool. The game, it's still great. It works really smooth. It's fun. It's fast. It's probably the heaviest Yahtzee-style game on the market. By far, it completely eclipses everything else. So if you like Yahtzee, but you want a game with a little bit more crunch than Roll Through the Ages or, King of Tokyo, this is definitely something to check out. Now, one thing I will say, though, is for Care Bear players like me and Jen, the game can be pretty cutthroat. You can make a lot of moves to really undercut your opponent and steal what they've worked hard for. If anything, I think now that Jen and I have played a bit more, it's probably a little bit too cutthroat for us. But if you're looking for a game with a lot of player interaction and a surprisingly deep game based on Yahtzee-style mechanisms and just a fun little city builder that captures the feel of its big brother, their urban sprawl with disasters and all kinds of fun stuff, you might want to check out Welcome to Centerville. That's it, folks. Just a quick update. Thanks very much for watching. Now, I forgot to mention right up front, you can hit that I in the top right corner screen or follow the show notes to go watch my original run-through of Centerville to get a better idea of how it all plays. But otherwise, I'm going to say thanks for watching. Have a very, very nice day. Talk to you later. So long. Bye-bye.